Well, this is a message for October 4, 2020. And our text is Luke 10, verses 5 through 9. It's the second part of the mission that Jesus gave to the 70 when he sent them out. I'm going to read from verse 1 just to get us back into the context of where we're at. After these things, the Lord appointed 70 others also, and sent them two by two before his face into every city and place where he himself was about to go. And then he said to them, "The harvest truly is great, but the laborers are few. Therefore pray the Lord of the harvest to send out laborers into his harvest. Go your way. Behold, I send you out as lambs among wolves. Carry neither money, bag, knapsack, nor sandals, and greet no one along the road." So he's sending them out on a mission, and basically it's an evangelistic type mission, to declare the kingdom of God and to preach the gospel in these cities where he's going. So he's preparing the way before him. And as they go out, he is saying that there's a great harvest out there. There's people who are ready to come to faith in Jesus Christ. And the harvest is great, but the laborers are few, and so he urges us to pray for laborers, that he might thrust them out into the harvest fields so that they can be reached with the gospel of Jesus Christ. And so we're to pray for that, but we're also to be involved in that ministry, as we saw last week. And so he says, "Go on out, and I send you out as lambs among wolves." It's not going to be easy. It's going to be dangerous. People are going to oppose us. If we take the gospel to people in this world, we're going out like a lamb among wolves, and they're going to eat us up or try to. But Jesus would be with them. God protects his own and until the time that he wants to call them home. And so, no matter what the opposition is, and we can expect that, we are to continue to take the gospel to every person, every creature, is to be extended this invitation of salvation through the gospel. And so he says, go out, don't carry anything extra. This is an urgent thing. Don't waste time greeting one another. That is, don't stop and talk to them and carry on a long conversation. Just go. This is so urgent, you can't stop along the way. Take nothing else with you. You will be provided for, basically, is what he's saying, and he will show in the coming verses. So we come to verse 5, and he says, "But whatever house you enter, first say, 'Peace to this house.'" So as they go out on this mission, they would be strangers in practically every town and village that they would enter. And when they entered a village to proclaim their message, they were to look for those who were receptive to it, those who were waiting part of the harvest, looking for the coming of the Messiah. And they were to wait for someone to extend to them an invitation to lodge with them overnight. And upon entering that house, they were to say, "Peace to this house." Now, this is much more than just a normal polite greeting. It's much more than just saying, you know, "Have a nice day, and I hope God blesses you." This was a declaration of the peace brought about by the gospel. Peace with God through faith in Jesus Christ. So it's not just wishing peace upon them, but actually bringing peace through the gospel. Those who were receptive and accepted the message and the King, Jesus Christ, would have peace. And he says in verse 6, "And if a son of peace is there, your peace will rest on it. If not, it will return to you." So a son of peace is a person who is characterized by peace. In other words, he's one who receives the message of peace through Jesus, the Messiah. He is a son of peace, and if he's a son of peace, then God's peace will rest upon him and his household. But if he's not a son of peace, if he hasn't received that message, and he hasn't received Jesus Christ, believed upon him, then the peace that is offered will stay and return back to the sender. It will return to the one who speaks that peace. It won't stay there. So if God's message, the gospel of Jesus Christ, is not received and believed upon, then there's no peace. It's like a gift that's refused and handed back. So if you offer someone a gift and say, here it is, remember the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord, right? He offers that gift. If you refuse it, you say, no, I don't want it, it returns back to the giver. Or if you take it and then take and give it back, say, I don't want it. So return back to him. Verse 7 says, and remain in the same house, eating and drinking such things as they give, for the laborer is worthy of his wages, and do not go from house to house. So if they enter a house, person offers them lodging and food there, they are to remain in that house, eating and drinking what's given. They're not to look for something else. They're not to go from house to house. They are to be content with what they receive. And they're not to leave just because they don't like some particular thing in the house or some type of food that is given to them. Don't leave a house to find a nicer accommodation or better food. Stay in that house where God has provided for you and be content with what you receive. This would distinguish them from the greedy false teachers that were so common in Israel. And these false teachers were constantly looking to stay at the most comfortable, wealthiest homes, and they would often move from house to house, taking advantage of as many rich people as they could. These false teachers would put a price on their ministry by demanding certain living arrangements and quality of food. That's not to be done, because God will provide. God will provide. There are ministers today who do the same thing. They demand a certain wage, or they demand a certain living conditions, and they have to have everything just right before they'll go to a place and minister. I've never done that. I've never once in the time I've been in the ministry, which is, let's see, about 40 years or more, I have never demanded a certain wage. I've never asked for a raise. And God has always supplied. He's promised to do that. So they were to go out trusting God. And he makes this statement. He says, because the laborer is worthy of his wages. In other words, a laborer is entitled to receive wages for his work. So they're not to be ashamed or reluctant and think bad about receiving food and lodging because they've earned it. They've earned that pay. They've earned those things. Deuteronomy 25, verse 4 says, you shall not muzzle an ox while it treads out the grain. So what he's talking about here is they use oxen to thresh out the grain, and they were used in two different ways. The sheaves of grain, after they were cut down and bundled together, were placed and spread on the ground, usually in a circle, and the oxen were driven over those sheaves of grain in order to remove the kernels of grain. And as the kernels were removed, it would be in a windy place, and the wind would blow the chaff away and would leave the grain lying on the floor, which they would gather up. Also, they would use oxen who were harnessed together to a sledge, and on which a driver stood or sit. He was either seated or stood, and he guided them over and around the sheaves to, again, remove the grains. On the bottom of this sledge, it had a sharp stones attached to the bottom in order to loosen the grain. Now, a cruel, inhumane person would muzzle the oxen so they couldn't eat the grain while they worked, so they'd get every bit they could. They weren't willing to part with anything. And the point here is that everyone who works, whether it's oxen or man or the minister of the gospel, has a right to partake of the fruit of his work. In other words, they have a right to receive wages for their labor and for their work. Paul addresses this a couple of times. Go to 1 Corinthians chapter 9, where I think is probably the most extensive teaching on this subject. 1 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 8. Actually, let's go back up to verse 7. I'm going to read from verse 7. Whoever goes toward his own expense, he's paid. Who plants a vineyard doesn't eat of the fruit, so he gets benefit from his work. Or who tends a flock and does not drink of the milk of the flock? Again, he works, he puts effort in, he labors, and he gets benefit back. He gets something back. Or do I say these things as a mere man, or does not the law say the same thing? He's talking of the law of Moses. For it's written in the law of Moses, you shall not muzzle an ox while it treads out the grain. Now, is it oxen God's concerned about? Is that what the whole point is, just for the oxen? Or does he say it all together for our sakes? Is it for the sake of man? Well, for our sakes, no doubt this is written that he who plows should plow in hope, and he who threshes in hope should be partaker of his hope. Well, he sums it up in verse 14. Even so, the Lord has commanded that those who preach the gospel should live from the gospel. In other words, they have a right to the wage, to wages for their labor. And so he's telling these 70 as they go out, someone invites you into their home and they give you food and lodging. You don't need to pay for it. That's your wages. You know, they should do that. Verse 8 says, whatever city you enter and they receive you, eat such things as are set before you. Now, the 70 were Jews, and they were going out into a region, especially on the east side of the Jordan River in Perea, where many Gentiles lived. And that could create a problem with food that's set before them. But the message of the gospel was not to be deterred or hampered by questions about food. Jesus is saying, don't be concerned about the Jewish dietary laws. Eat whatever is set before you and don't ask questions. Jesus had addressed this issue about foods defiling a person before. If you want to go back to Mark chapter 7. And it, Jesus says in verse 14, when he had called all the multitude to himself, he said to them, "Hear me, everyone, and understand, there's nothing that enters a man from outside which can defile him, but the things which come out of him, those are the things that defile a man. If anyone has ears to hear, let him hear." And when he had entered a house away from the crowd, his disciples asked him concerning the parable, and he said, "Are you thus without understanding also? Do you not perceive that whatever enters a man from outside cannot defile him? Because it does not enter his heart, but his stomach, and to eliminate it, thus purifying all foods." The Pharisees and the scribes had come up to Jesus and asked him, "Why do your disciples not walk according to the tradition of the elders, but eat bread without unwashed hands?" Jesus refutes that, because the Pharisees and the scribes and the rabbis taught that to eat with unwashed hands defiled the food, which in turn defiled a person. He became unclean. He became a sinner. So they thought that food made you a sinner, unclean before God. And so Jesus refutes that, and he shows that it's not food that defiles a person. That's not what makes you a sinner. True defilement of a person is a heart issue, he is saying. It's not an outward physical thing where something you touch with unwashed hands makes you a sinner. And so he says whatever we eat physically is eventually eliminated from the body. The food enters the stomach, not the heart. How then can a person be unclean or defiled because of food? It's the heart. It's out of the heart where sin. Sin comes from inside, not from outside. So don't be worried about what you eat, whether it's unclean or not. Just eat what's set before you. Ask no questions. Verse 9, he says, "And heal the sick there, and say to them, the kingdom of God has come before you, come near you." So they were to heal those who were sick. We also know from verse 17 that they cast out demons. It says in verse 17, the 70 returned with joy, saying, "Lord, even the demons are subject to us in your name." The ability to heal and cast out demons were credentials, the certification that their message was from God. God used miraculous powers and sign gifts to authenticate the message of the apostles and the early church until the completion of the inspired New Testament. And then they passed away. And so they were to preach the gospel. Now, the phrase there, "the kingdom of God has come near you," I think is a summary of the message they were to bring to the people. It's not the only message, or only thing they said, I don't think. And the kingdom of God is the realm in which God rules. And by saying that the kingdom had come near, or literally upon them, Jesus was not saying there was no future fulfillment concerning the kingdom. The day is still coming when Jesus will return and reign upon the earth for 1,000 years, physically, on earth. The point is that the kingdom in its initial stage had arrived in the person of Jesus, and they were to submit to him as the king of their lives. God, right now, at this present time, rules in the hearts and lives of those who believe upon Jesus Christ. Those who have placed their faith in Jesus Christ are in the kingdom. So the kingdom today is the realm of God ruling in the hearts and lives of those who believe upon Jesus Christ. And one cannot enter the kingdom of God or the kingdom of heaven without being born again. John chapter 3, remember, reminds us of that. John chapter 3, verse 1 says, there's a man of the Pharisees named Nicodemus, the ruler of the Jews. This man came to Jesus by night and said to him, Rabbi, we know that your teacher come from God, for no one can do these signs that you do unless God is with him. And Jesus answered and said to him, most assuredly, I say to you, unless one is born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. That's as clear as you can get. Jesus himself says, you cannot be in the kingdom unless you're born again. That's the criteria. Nicodemus said to him, how can a man be born when he's old? Can he enter a second time into his mother's womb and be born? So Nicodemus doesn't understand. How's that possible? How can you be born again? And Jesus said, most assuredly, I say to you, unless one is born of water and the Spirit, he cannot enter the kingdom of God. Now, what is he talking about there? He's talking about a physical birth and a spiritual birth, because that's explained in the next verse. To be born of water, when a person is born physically, it involves water. Water breaks, that's a sign that the birth is about to happen. In the womb, the water that surrounds the baby in the womb. So, and he says that, he makes that distinction in verse 6, that which is born of flesh is flesh. That which is born of the Spirit is spirit. Right? Do not marvel that I said to you, you must be born again. The wind blows where it wishes, and you hear the sound of it, but cannot tell where it comes from and where it goes. So is everyone who is born of the Spirit. But he's talking about a spiritual birth. Being born from above by the act of God. You're made a new creation. You cannot be part of the kingdom now or in the future. The promise is that those who believe upon Jesus Christ will rule and reign with Christ on the earth for 1,000 years. But you cannot be part of that unless you have believed upon Jesus Christ. And the question is, have you done that? Have you believed upon Jesus Christ to the saving of your soul? Have you been born again? Have you trusted him? If not, why don't you do that? You can do that even today. Whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. If you believe upon Jesus Christ, put all your trust and faith in him, you gain eternal life and you become those who will have part in the kingdom of God and rule and reign with him, not just for 1,000 years, but forever and ever. Let's pray. Father, we thank you that we can be part of the kingdom and we can have that assurance through faith in Jesus Christ. We just praise you for that. I do pray, God, if there is anyone who's listening to this sermon today, does not believe that by your grace, by your Spirit and your work, they might be brought to repentance and faith in Jesus Christ. I pray in Christ's name. Amen.